good. I'm always nervous to step up after Craig. He's the guy, if you're even on the fence about coming that Saturday, he's the guy that I always go to when I have issues with my PowerPoint or with my presentations or anything. He's the guy that gets it all done. So he's really good. I hope you guys will join him because it's going to be really beneficial. Tonight, we are going to start a new series. Tonight's series is going to start with Servants of the Servant. And I just felt compelled to do this after some conversations that we've had over the last 6 months as a team, talking about a volunteer base for a church. We've talked a lot about it in staff meetings and just kind of around campus and what it means for us. Generationally, I mean, for years and decades, the old cliche has been in place in church that says 20% of the congregation does 80% of the work. It's been there ever since we can remember, and we're not even sure if it's statistically correct. We just kind of throw it around, but the basic meaning of it is there's a small percentage of the congregation that does the majority of the volunteer work. And you see the evidence of that when you come to various events and you consistently see the same faces over and over and over again serving. And many of you are part of that 20% that we kind of say is doing 80% of the work. The interesting thing that I kind of have thought about as I was writing this message is that as churches have required or looked for a higher education in their staff members and their senior pastors, the volunteer base has also dwindled. So as they have hired with a higher expectation, the load gets bigger incrementally on those that are hired. For those that a generation ago that were senior pastors and didn't have a degree at all, that same position now typically has a bachelor's degree. For that position a generation ago that had a bachelor's degree, typically now it's a master's degree. In fact, most large churches that are really focused on having a guy that is really going after it, they won't even look at a candidate unless he has a doctorate degree. The interesting thing, though, to me is that, in me being one that has gone after a higher education, just having a higher education and having $100,000 worth of student loans doesn't mean that you have an extra 8 hours in the day to do things. And it doesn't mean that you have the extra physical or even the mental capacity to go above and beyond what someone a generation ago that was highly intelligent has either. So we've got this dynamic going on right now where churches or boards expect more out of their pastors, and I'm not talking about here, I'm talking about the church abroad. They expect more out of their pastors while the volunteer base is dwindling. And so it's an interesting dynamic, and the church is headed towards a crossroads where they have to figure out, okay, either one of two things. We either have to have less available for the congregation, or we have to increase our volunteer base. There's only one of two ways to go. The thing about it is that when you look at different statistics that have been put out, there's specifically a study that was done by the New York Times. It wasn't done by a small group or by a small church. It was the New York Times put out a study in 2010, and they started the article by saying, members of the clergy now suffer from obesity, hypertension, and depression at rates higher than most Americans. In the last decade, their use of antidepressants has risen, while their life expectancy has fallen. Many would change jobs if they could. Now we're going to look at a couple of the statistics that they put out in this study just to give you an idea of what is happening as the volunteer base is dwindling and the expectations on the pastor is rising. 13% of pastors are divorced. 23% have been fired or pressured to resign at least once in their careers. 25% don't know where to turn when they have a family or personal conflict or issue. 25% of pastors' wives see their husband's work schedule as a source of conflict. 33% felt burned out within their first 5 years of ministry. 40% of pastors and 47% of spouses are suffering from burnout, frantic schedules, and or unrealistic expectations. 45% of pastors say that they've experienced depression, burnout, to the extent that they needed to take a leave of absence from ministry. 50% feel unable to meet the needs of the job. 57% would leave the pastorate if they had somewhere else to go or some other vocation that they could do. 70% say that they don't have any close friends. 56% of pastors' wives say that they have no close friends. 75% report severe stress causing anguish, worry, bewilderment, anger, depression, fear, and alienation. 80% of pastors say they have insufficient time with their spouse. 80% believe that pastoral ministry affects their families negatively. 90% feel unqualified or poorly prepared for ministry. 90% work more than 50 hours a week. 94% feel under pressure to have a perfect family. Doctors, lawyers, and clergy have the most problems with drug abuse, alcoholism, and suicide. And lastly, 1,500 pastors leave their ministries each month due to burnout, conflict, or moral failure. The fact of the matter is ministry is difficult. There's a lot of pressure. In fact, a lot of doctors won't even do any kind of blood tests or blood pressure checks on pastors on Monday because of the stress of Sunday that it puts on him. They'd rather wait until later on in the week to where everything levels out and they get a better reading. The fact of the matter is that it is very stressful. And you ask JT, why did you bring me here for a guilt trip or for a pity party? Why are you, you're going to take an offering up at the end? That's not what we're doing here. It's not at all. And I want to tell you from all of us on our staff, there's not a single person that I think that would say otherwise. We love what we do, and we love you, and that's why we do it, and we love God, and that's why we do it. And you guys pay us well to do what we do. But it doesn't change the fact that it is a very stressful job. What I hope to do over the next hour and a half and the next few weeks is to just kind of open the eyes of a few and hopefully many about what the scriptures say about the believer's responsibility to serve others, because I think it's important within the context of everything that we've talked about. The Hartford Institute for Religion Research released findings of a study that they did on 153 churches across America in 2005. And the findings suggest that the whole 20% that do the 80% of the work in the church is actually drastically wrong. The number is actually closer to 7%. Now tonight I want to put that a little bit in context for you. If you were to take Sunday morning on a good Sunday when we have a good attendance, now I'm not talking about anybody that's over in Kidstown or in Merge, or in the foyer, anybody that's already serving or over in the other buildings, I'm just trying to give you a grasp of the numbers is all I'm trying to do. So if you just take the numbers that are in the sanctuary on a Sunday, on a well-attended Sunday, somewhere between 600 and 650 are in the room on a good Sunday on one service. Now, if you push back just that same number, just to have conversation around it, the 7%, because it could be over that or under that here at this church, but just to have conversation around 7%, pushed back on that 600 to 650, you're looking at 42 volunteers at this church. 42 volunteers that would help man the nursery, help serve in various rooms in Kidstown, serve as sheriffs in Kidstown, serve as leaders in Merge, serve at the info center, as greeters, parking team, work in the kitchen, take orders and money at the register, usher during Sunday services, man the cameras, man the soundboard, video equipment, serve on the praise team, serve in the band, help put communion supplies out before anyone gets here, host a power of three group from their home, serve on the intercessory and prayer team, serve at the senior adult luncheon, serve on the security team, serve as a leader on the Simply Care team, and the list goes on and on and on. There's a lot going on at Generations United, and that's a great thing. The bottom line is there's never a shortage of something to do for someone in this congregation. So why is the percentage so low? And again, not just in this church, but church abroad, across the nation, why is the percentage of people that are willing to stand up and say, I'll do my part, I'll sign up to be able to serve, even if it's once a month, or maybe it's three times a month, or whatever it may be, why is it so difficult for people to cross that line? Tonight I'm going to talk about a couple of those questions, or a couple of those things that people say on general about why they can't serve or why they don't want to serve. And I think some of them will probably register with you. Number one, I simply don't have the time. This is probably one of the most common things that people say when they're not able to serve the church. I don't have the time. It's no mystery in our culture. As individuals, our greatest resource that we have is time. Some would argue that, but in my opinion, standing here, your greatest resource is time. Because with more time, we can gain greater knowledge. With more time, we can gain more wealth. With more time, we can foster genuine relationships. With more time, we can leave a legacy. More time is something we all want and something we all need, but it is the one variable that never changes, that we cannot hold on to. It's the one thing that we can't take and save and put in our back pocket and use it later, because no matter how much we want to, it continues to move, continues to sink between our fingers. There's nothing that we can do, and as we get older, it seems to move faster. And it seems to be the one thing that we can't get back, we can't get enough of, and that's time. It seems like there's something that always falls through the crack because we can't get enough of that time. I know for me personally, I've found myself over the last few days, and I know that sounds weird, but I'm going to explain. Over the last few days, I've gotten a little bit of that precious resource back in my own life. This past weekend, I turned in my last assignment for my master's degree. And over the last few days, I've come home. I mean, the first day I came home, my wife looked at me and goes, so what are you going to do? And I looked at her and said, I'm not really sure. It's the one resource that I got a little bit of it back. And I can't tell you how different it feels, because just to give you an idea, I not only serve as a worship pastor here at Generations United, I'm also the AVL director, I'm also the IT facilitator. On top of that, I'm married, I have two children, both play sports, one of them plays travel soccer. So in many times of the year, we have four practices a week at different times, at different locations. We have travel tournaments on the weekends. Up until last weekend, I was taking four master's level classes per semester. And I'm not bragging or stroking my ego, what I'm saying is I get it. I understand. I'm not sitting up here preaching to you or preaching at you. I get it. I get it that time is our greatest resources, and it is the thing that we can't get more of it, no matter how much we want to pay or who we talk to. There's no magic tree of time that we can get it back from. I get it. I'm pulling out a lot of stats for you tonight, but I just want to give you an understanding of where our culture is now and where we are as individuals. There was a Gallup poll in 2007 that was conducted to find out the correlation between time and stress within our culture. The results showed that 47% of individuals that were interviewed said that they don't have enough time to get everything done. Out of that 47% of people that said that, 54% of them said that they experienced stress because of that, which is double the amount of people that experience stress that felt like they do have enough time to get everything done. The bottom line is that the lack of time to get things done causes stress in our lives, stress all around, stress at the house, stress on our spouses. It's something that wears on us every day. But there's one thing that I kind of wanted to bring to light to you. Sometimes people don't have a problem with time, but they have a problem with time management. I know with myself even sometimes that I'll go home, and if I didn't have any schoolwork, I'd sit down, and I found myself just relaxing for a few minutes, and then 3 hours later, I realized I'm still sitting there, and I realized it's time to go to bed, and I haven't read my Bible, and I haven't prayed, and that's not a lack of time. That's a lack of time management. And I'm guilty of it as well. Matthew 6:21 says, "For where your treasure is, there also will your heart be." If you treasure something, you'll find a way to get to it. You'll find a way to spend time with that person. You'll find a way to get more of it. You'll find a way to do whatever satisfies the worship of that treasure. In this case, the gospel is speaking of the only thing that is worthy of making a treasure in your heart, and that is Christ. He's saying if there's anything else that is taking your attention away from him, then you've got your focus on something that is not eternal. In John 21, Christ asked Peter 3 times, "Do you love me?" And each time, Peter responds with, "Of course I do. You know that. You know everything. Why would you even question that?" On the 3rd time, he's almost getting frustrated with Christ. He's saying, "You know I do." But Christ continually responds with, "Then feed my sheep. Then take care of my lambs. Then feed my sheep." Who are his sheep? His sheep are his people. Christ says, if you love me, if I am your treasure, if I am your focus, if I am where your heart is, then take care of my people. And he's not talking to paid staff members. He's not talking to the senior pastor. He's talking to every one of us. Christ says, if I am truly your treasure, where your heart is, and you love me, then serve my people. Feed my sheep. Sometimes it's a matter of priorities. Sometimes it's a matter of sitting down at the table and writing down, what is it that I do every day? What is it that I mean, we talked about it in one of our developmental meetings that we did as a team, blocking out your weekly calendar and saying, what do I do here? What do I do here? What do I do here? And seeing where the critical things are, where the non-critical things are, and where the times of just pure waste are. And getting rid of those times of waste and consolidating things so you can get more done. Sometimes it takes us to sit down and say, what is it that really occupies my mind and my focus every week? And Christ says, if it's anything other than me, if it's anything other than giving me glory, if it's any activity that isn't focused on giving me glory, then maybe you need to check where your heart is. Maybe you need to see what your treasure is, because we can't take our golf clubs with us to heaven. Now, I'd love to tell you there's going to be a golf course in heaven, but I can't promise it. But we can't take our money with us. We can't take our clothes, our boats, our cars, our Xboxes, our softball gloves, our TVs. There will be Netflix in heaven, I can promise you that, but you can't take your TVs with you. But yet we're so distracted by all of these things that Christ says, your heart's going to be where your treasure is. Number 2, I'm not qualified enough. There's a lot of people that say this as well. They just don't feel like they're prepared enough to step in and serve in any capacity. A lot of people feel like they have to be able to spout out 24 scriptures by memory, or spout out the 16 fundamental truths of the Assembly of God, or the motto of the Royal Rangers, or be able to name all the disciples, or be able to speak in tongues, be able to counsel individuals. I don't have nice enough clothes. I don't fit the mold. I'm not pretty enough. Whatever the case may be, everybody's walked through that from time to time, whether or not it was the beginning of what you did when you served, or maybe it's still now. The fear of I'm not good enough has kept people sitting in the pews for generations, disabling the enabled from realizing their own purpose in the kingdom of God. You say, why do I say disabling the enabled? Romans 8, 26 through 27 says, meanwhile, the moment we get tired in the waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside helping us along. If we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. He does our praying in and for us, making prayer out of our wordless sighs, our aching groans. He knows us far better than we know ourselves, knows our pregnant condition, and keeps us present before God. And this is the part that I love right here. That's why we can be so sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. That last part is so important because it says anything we do in our life of love for God, as long as it brings glory to God and we're not seeking glory for ourselves, He will work it out in the end. He will use it for His good. You hear people say, pastors say, God doesn't call the equipped, He equips the called. It's the same thing. It's what the anointing is for. God will never call you to something, whether it's serving in the kitchen, serving in the nursery, serving on the praise team, or if it's full-time ministry, God will never call you to something that you can do on your own. Why would He do that? If what you feel like God is calling you to serve in doesn't scare you a little bit, then it's not God. He wants to challenge you. He wants to be the one that gets glory for what happens. If that isn't convincing enough, let's go back to the scriptures. David is one of the most revered men in the Old Testament. I think we would all agree in that. He was a great military conqueror in his time, yet he couldn't conquer his own demons at times. What do we always remember about David? David killed Goliath, right? He was a victorious commander on the field of battle. He's listed in Hebrews 11 in the so-called Hall of Fame of the Old Testament with guys like Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Rahab, and the list goes on. But this is pretty good company for him to be sitting in. I think you'd agree. He was an ancestor of Christ, a man that God used to fulfill the covenant. But lastly, and I think this is the one that I love the most, and I think you could probably identify with, because there's always that moment when you're a child, when your dad or your mom looks at you and says, I'm proud of you. Or, you know, you remind me a little bit of me when I was young. When we go to Acts 13:22, we see, after removing Saul, he made David their king. He testified concerning him, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. Now, if you say that wouldn't make you proud, then something's wrong with you. But in order to see the significance of all of this in this illustration, we have to go back to the beginning of David's story. We have to go back to the very beginning of 1 Samuel 16, which says, and it begins to talk about when Samuel's walking into the house of Jesse and he's beginning to listen to God, to who God is going to name the next king. And he goes through all the sons. None of them are there. We go to the scriptures and it says, then he asked Jesse, is this it? Are there no more sons? Well, yes, there's the runt. But he's out tending the sheep. Samuel ordered Jesse, go get him. We're not moving from this spot until he's here. Samuel didn't say, go down to Southeastern University and get David from where he's at seminary. He didn't say, go down to the temple where he's been studying and he's been training. He didn't say, go down to the city streets where he's been preaching for 40 years. That's not what he said. He said, go to fields where David is, pull him out from tending sheep. This great man who's listed in the Hall of Fame of the Old Testament, when he was called into service, was tending sheep. And it doesn't say that they brought him back and got him dressed up for Samuel. Never says that. So I just picture David walking in, dirty, stinky, right off the field, out of breath because he's been rushed in. And Samuel says, that's the guy. That's the guy that God is making king today. A sheep herder that God said, I see something in him that will make a world of difference. Number three, I have too much in my past. The old trick of guilt, shame, everything that happened in the past starts reliving in your mind. We all have a past. We all have things in our past that we're not proud of. We all have things in our past that if the person sitting next to you right now were to know about it, you would be embarrassed and want to crawl underneath the table or underneath your chair. But let me tell you a story about a man who had a past. Born in Puerto Rico in 1938 to two parents that practiced something called spiritism, he openly admitted that he knew that he was placed in the womb of a witch. His father used to place him in a closet with pigeons that would tear at his flesh every day. His mom used to beat him so hard until he was knocked unconscious. He was abused mentally on a regular basis, with his own mother calling him the son of Satan. Growing up in Puerto Rico, he was constantly getting in trouble so much that his parents just, they couldn't deal with it anymore. So they sent him to New York to live with his brother when he was only 15 years old. And of course, it didn't take long for him to get connected with the gangs in New York. And it was only 6 months later when he was elected the warlord over the gang. When he was asked about that time in his life, he said it was a kill or be killed type of situation. Only the strong survive. And when they asked him specifically point blank in the interview whether or not he ever killed anybody, he said, I'd rather not respond to that, but I will tell you, as a gang, we did. Simply put, he was inflicting all the pain that he had experienced during his childhood back on others. He was living out of anger, pain, resentment, and everything that had been placed upon him. Now stay with me for a second. We're going to pull away from that, and I'm going to tell you a story of another man, a different man. This man founded an outreach program that helps teenagers with troubled lives, which stretches across the U.S., Latin America, and Europe. He's also the founder of many halfway houses, which help in the rehabilitation of drug addicts. He's a member of the honorary committee of the presidential prayer team, which includes others like Gerald Ford, Jerry Colangelo, and others. He's written 17 books, one of which has sold over 14 million copies worldwide, entitled Run, Baby, Run. By this time, you may know who I'm talking about. Both of these men are the same men, yet different. This is Nicky Cruz. Nicky Cruz is well known for being one of the most dynamic stories of the grace of God. When God sent David Wilkerson into his life to speak grace into him, he was confronted with love. David Wilkerson explained to Cruz that there was a God who loved him and wanted to change him forever, and Cruz spit in his face, slapped him, and said he was going to kill him. Wilkerson simply replied, "You can kill me, you can cut me into 1,000 pieces, but each one of those pieces will still love you." It was that seed of love that was planted in Nicky Cruz that set in motion the most dramatic testimony of God's grace. But yet, so many say, I've got too much in my past to be able to serve. I've got too much in my past to make an impact on anybody else. I'll tell you one more story on this one, and then we'll move on. This one a little bit closer. Most of all of you know that I was a preacher's kid, and very early in life began working in ministry, in music ministry. But as I got older, I allowed pride to get into my heart about the giftings that God had given me. And I strayed from the church for a long time. I ran from the church, and those things that we talked about in your past that you're embarrassed about, you're ashamed about, I have many of them in those 10 years in my past. When my wife and I moved to Nashville and I rededicated my life and I began to start going to a church there locally, an Assembly of God church in Nashville, I started getting a little closer with the worship pastor there, and he became a good friend of mine, and he kind of came to understand that I used to sing and used to play. And he asked me one day, he said, "So when are you going to come back to that God gave you in order to serve?" And I looked at him in that moment, and I was just coming off having spoke to the men's breakfast and talking to them about my testimony, and I explained to them that I saw my life as a rock, that when I gave my life to Christ, the rock had many jagged edges, and Christ sandblasted that rock and knocked off those edges. But then when you turned over the rock to the other side, there were still some small edges that Christ said, "I've brought you through grace. You're here with me forever. But let's work on those things together now and get those things worked out." And I just come off of talking about that with the men's breakfast, and I looked at Greg and I said, "You know, I've got a few things left in my life that I'm working out. I've got a lot of things in my past. I've got still a few things that I just need to work them out before I start serving." And he looked me dead in the eye, and this was the moment that changed my life forever. And he said, "If you wait until you're perfect to serve, you'll never serve." And it was that light bulb moment for me when he said that. And I stepped into the choir is all I did. And within a year, I was leading worship in Birmingham and Kingwood. And within a year or so after that, we were on to full-time ministry. The only one that speaks shame and guilt into your life to keep you from serving is the enemy. God will never speak guilt and shame if you put it under the blood. It's gone. It's gone. If you wait until you're perfect to serve, you'll never serve. We're going to take about a 15-minute intermission, and then we're going to move forward with number 4, which is entitled "Too Much Shame in My Name." So you guys go ahead and take a break, and we'll start back at, let's start back at 7:20. How's that? All right. Welcome back, guys. Appreciate you sticking around with us for the last part of this part of the series. We're going to wrap it up with a couple more points. I'm not going to keep you too long tonight, but I just wanted to cover a couple more. I promised you before you left we would cover "Too Much Shame in My Name," and let me explain where I'm going with that. There's some people in this room that this may resonate with, and there's some people that it probably won't resonate with, but I believe that in every congregation that there are some of those that are in the crowd that feel like their heritage or their last name brings a certain amount of shame along with it because of what has happened, and they don't feel worthy to serve in any capacity because of their heritage. And so I want to go back to the scriptures, and we're going to go to the New Testament. We're actually going to go to where the New Testament really starts, not where everybody thinks it starts, in verse 18 of chapter 1, which skips the begats. We're going to go actually to the beginning of the New Testament. Most people just see no purpose of the begats and skip right past them, but there is a purpose in them, and the author always has a reason for putting them in there. It is the infallible Word of God, and so we know that there is stuff in there for us to glean out of. And so we're going to talk about that for just a second. Without going too far off of the reservation real quick, I want to talk about why Matthew begins with the begats. He is taking everything that has happened in the Old Testament, the prophecies, the accounts, everything that has happened there, the covenants, everything that we've read up to that point, and he is connecting it to Christ. He's connecting it to the completion of the story. He's connecting it in a way that would make sense. He does it through the genealogy of Jesus. He also does this for another reason that some people don't realize, is that he's trying to connect with the reader that Christ didn't just come to the earth for the Jews, but the Gentiles as well. The genealogy not only includes Jews, but it includes Gentiles alike. To explain that to the reader, that this is a salvation for the whole world. But there's also something else that is hidden within the genealogy that I don't know that Matthew did on purpose, but I think that it's there that we can understand something for our own hearts in the context of this. See, some of us feel like we're not able to be used by God because of our past. Some of us believe because of what's going on in our life today. But some of us believe because of our heritage that we're not worthy. Some doubt our usefulness because of where we come from. The shame of things that have happened in our family still overshadow what we see as our usefulness for God. And the shame that some feel due to the things that have gone on in their family for generations is difficult to overcome sometimes. But if we look at Matthew 1:1 through 17, there's something very interesting in this regard. When listing over 30 generations of descendants of Christ, he lists just 4 women. And I believe that he does this for 2 reasons, one of which we've already established in the fact that some of them were foreigners, earmarking the fact that Christ had Gentile blood. But the other is that these 4 women that are listed in the genealogy of Christ all have things in their past. Look at Tamar. Tamar tricks Judah to impregnate her by disguising herself as a shrine prostitute in Genesis 38. Rahab, in Joshua 2, we see that she was a prostitute with a pagan background. Ruth, in Ruth chapter 3, we see Ruth's unique position, which was gained with Boaz through an almost deceptive and seductive manner at the threshing floor. Bathsheba's situation with David was a little questionable. It doesn't specifically say in the scriptures whether or not she was forced to or whether or not she went along with it. But either way, there was some difficulty there in her life. The reason I bring this up, the reason I speak about these 4 women in the genealogy of Christ, is to tell you that if you're sitting in the chairs today and saying that I've got too much in my heritage, my name is damaged, I'm here to tell you that it's okay, because Christ had some craziness in his background too. There's nothing in your life that God can't deal with. It doesn't matter if your last name you feel is tainted. This is another thing that the enemy uses to keep you on the bench and keep you from getting plugged in and making an impact for the Lord. Number 5. I'm too old. No, you're not, Rock. Many of us look forward to retirement. I mean, a lot of us look forward to that, to be able to have a time where we can slow down a little bit, things aren't as rushed, we can maybe have some time to do some things that we really want to do. We can spend time with family, we can maybe take the trips that we're able to take or that we're wanting to take. Doesn't always work out that way. But that's what we look forward to, hopefully, in retirement. But the question is there ever such a thing as retirement in the kingdom of God, or retirement from serving God and serving others? Psalms 92:12-15 describes the righteous that serve God, and specifically in verse 14 it says, "They shall still bear fruit in old age, they shall be fresh and flourishing." Now, what does this passage suggest? Do you see anything about retirement in the kingdom of God and serving others because of age? It says here that no matter how old you are, there is a purpose for you in the kingdom of God. There is something that you can do for others. Furthermore, if we look in the scriptures, Moses and Aaron were 80 and 83 when they were chosen to lead the Israelites out of Egyptian bondage. Joshua was approximately 80 when he was given the task of leading the conquest of Canaan and did so for another 30 years. Daniel was well over 80 when he was thrown into the lion's den. Zacharias and Elizabeth were both said to be well advanced in years when they were serving in the temple and Elizabeth gave birth to John the Baptist. Paul refers to himself as the aged in Philemon 9 when he was still writing, traveling, visiting, and encouraging churches after being released from prison. And I would tell you that traveling and encouraging churches is not like it is now, getting into a Lincoln Town car or getting on a flight and traveling somewhere. In that time, if you are aged and you're traveling to different churches, it is a big deal. It's a very physically challenging deal. But Paul was doing this on up into his age. So let me ask the question, are you ever too old to serve? The Bible talks about those that are up in years but have been with Christ, that they are the ones that we should be asking. They're the ones we should be leaning on. But for some reason in our culture, we tend to kind of push them out at times. But I want to tell you, if you're those that are moving on up in age, that you have a place in this church, and we need you more than ever to step up and be influential in this church and serve in a way that would be influential on our youth, on our 20-somethings, our 30-somethings. There's not a single person in this room that can't be used. I don't have a slide for this one, but I also want to just kind of piggyback off on that and say, are you ever too young to serve the Lord? This is another thing that we kind of discount, that we kind of at times push the young away and say, just go over there and play, or this isn't your time yet. I want us to be careful of that, because there are those that are listening, and if they get pushed to the side, they think that their usefulness is, they carry that with them through their ages and times. There's not a single person that will be in this room on Sunday that doesn't have a usefulness for Christ. Whether they're too young or too old, there's no such thing. Christ can use everyone no matter what their age. Number six is the fear of commitment. Whether or not we're talking about career, marriage, or faith, studies back up the observation that in 2008 specifically, more than half of people in ages 20 to 24 had only been within their current employer less than a year. The commitment level of the newer generations is a lot different than the older generations. There's a reason for that. We have given them the ability to pick and choose whatever they want. And I'm a part of that generation to a certain extent, so I'm not bashing anybody. But our culture has become one that you can get anything at your fingertips very quickly. And most of it you can get for free. And so if we walk into a church service, or if we walk into a career for that matter, and it doesn't fit exactly who we are, exactly what we want, and it doesn't meet our need, we just pull up our tent pegs and move on to the next thing. The lack of commitment is something that has been abundantly clear over the past decade and has been the source of the seeker-friendly churches that only have the flow into their church and are more worried about keeping people than reaching the lost. But it's part of the commitment issue that we have. Another issue with commitment is that people are getting hurt in churches where they serve, and they're afraid of getting burned again. You know, whether or not it's intentional or it's unintentional, people get hurt in churches. Some people say that people get hurt in churches more than anywhere else. You know, the mission of God is not the church. The mission of God is to reach every single person on earth with the gospel, and to see them developed into a spiritual or a mature spiritual being. The church simply gets into the flow of that mission. The issue is, though, that the church is not these four buildings or the four walls of this building. The church is those that sit in the chairs. The church is the people. The church is managed on a daily basis and run by all of us, which are humans, which are imperfect beings. A church is a messy thing. I was talking to a gentleman a while back, and he had kind of expressed to me the hurt that he had gone through by the church, with a tragic event that had happened, and the church really didn't come to his side. And he was really disappointed, and it kind of pushed him away from church. But then he also told me about the service, the community service that he had been doing with another group that was, it was not related to the church, but they did a lot of great work. And he was telling me about the people that that they had made an influence on, that one gentleman that had cancer, and they had done everything they could do, given them food, given them money to be able to survive. And I looked at him, I said, you're doing the work of Christ. You're showing the love of Christ. You've just taken him out of the element. You've taken him out of the equation. And I said, show me 10 men, and I'll show you 10 men that will disappoint you. I can't ever promise you that the church won't disappoint you, the church won't hurt you. But I know that Christ will never disappoint you. There are those in this room, I guarantee it, that have been hurt in ministry in another church, serving, and something happened, whether or not it was intentional or unintentional, and you've been hurt, or you've been damaged. Some of you have moved on, some of you have not. Some of you are afraid to commit now because of what happened. All I can tell you is that man will always disappoint you. But if you keep your focus and keep your eyes on the real reason that we serve, Christ will never disappoint you. Never. Commitment is a big issue for us. And the biggest issue for commitment is that if we're never willing to commit, then we'll never reach that intimate level of relationship with people. And that's what it's all about. When Christ was on earth, he ministered to people in the masses. That's true. But he had a small group that he poured his life into on an intimate level. A lot of people call that evangelism. Discipleship. There's a new church model that I just got done studying called the hybrid church. The hybrid church takes the best of both worlds, the small cell church, which is 20 or under, and the mega church. They want to take the best of both worlds, the intimacy of the small group setting. They believe that that's the only way you can reach the intimacy and the spiritual formation. The connectivity of people is have that small cell church, but they also want the impact of the mega church. So what they do is they have a ton of small churches that meet during the week, but then on Sunday, they rent out an arena, and they all come together for worship once a week. So they have the intimacy of a small group like Christ with the disciples, pouring into each other, living life together. But then they have the impact to be able to reach the community with the financial resources and those kind of things that it needs. I say all that to say this. You have two choices. You honestly do. You can come in late, you can leave early, and you can have just the preaching to the masses and move on. You can do that. That's up to you. There's nothing wrong with that. You'll still go to heaven. I'll still see you there. I'll still play golf with you if you want me to. But the intimacy and the connected part of that, where we're able to live life together and walk through life together, spiritual formation, lean on each other, never happens until you're willing to commit and connect. Whether or not you're afraid to connect because of past hurt or because it's just how you've been raised, I challenge you to commit for just a little while and see if it doesn't change your life. I'll tell you, one of the things that helped me when I first gave my life back to Christ was playing softball. Because you go to the ball field with 10 guys, but then once you get to church, those 10 guys have other friends that you get introduced to, and then those relationships spin off, and before you know it, you're connected. 6 months, connect to something. Dedicate yourself to serve for 6 months somewhere, whether or not it's once a month, 3 times a month, 3 times a week, whatever it may be, serve somewhere in a meaningful way. I promise it'll change your life forever. The last reason that people don't serve is they simply don't know how or what they can sign up to. It's the most simple problem of them all, but it is a problem. Funny thing is these little cards are available to everybody every Sunday. Simply says volunteer opportunities, and it has every area that you can volunteer in. It has opportunities that you can serve in once a month if you're still worried about the time aspect. Has opportunities to serve multiple times in a month. If you have some physical ailments, there's some things in there that you can serve in that will accommodate that. There's no one in this room that couldn't sign up to serve something. Serve God, serve others in a way that would get you connected. In the next coming weeks, we're going to talk a little bit about, and I'm going to leave these here, by the way. I'm going to leave them right here in case anybody would like one. The next couple of weeks, we're going to talk a little bit about servant-hearted leaders in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and how they served Christ through a multitude of different arenas and ways. And I think you'll benefit from it. We're going to walk through the Old Testament, the New Testament. We're going to speak about Christ specifically, and then we're going to bring it back home with us here contextually. So I hope that you will take this that we've talked about tonight, and it will challenge your heart, because I know that those of you that are not serving currently, that one of these has hit home. I know it has. I challenge you to rethink that this week and come back on Sunday, or take one of these now. Find a way to connect and serve. Let's pray.